Number 2, 3, 9.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Today we are celebrating Pentecost, and so our readings are on page 1006, 1006. If you'd like to open your book and mark the page with a ribbon. Because it is Pentecost, we also will just recite together the Pentecost sequence after the second reading. And that text is in the book as well. And the second reading, there are options. We will do the second one of the second reading. And we will do the second gospel reading, which is listed there. Our opening hymn is number 245. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
From the very beginning of creation, we as human beings have desired to be in union with God. And we continue that desire for us as individuals, as families, as a parish, and just all of humanity. We give thanks to God today for the infusing of the Holy Spirit in our lives, and we ask Him for His mercy for the times when we have been resistant to the workings of the Holy Spirit. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words,
in what I have done,
what I have failed to do,
to my fault, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin,
all angels and saints,
and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
And may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who by the mystery of today's great feast, sanctify your whole church in every people and nation, pour out, we pray, the gifts of the Holy Spirit across the face of the earth. And with the divine grace that was at work when the gospel was first proclaimed, fill now once more the hearts of believers. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When the time for Pentecost was fulfilled, they were all in one place together. And suddenly there came from the sky a noise like a strong driving wind, and it filled the entire house in which they were. Then there appeared to them tongues as of fire, which parted and came to rest on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in different tongues as the Spirit enabled them to proclaim. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven staying in Jerusalem. At this sound, they gathered in a large crowd, but they were confused because each one heard them speaking in his own language. They were astounded and in amazement they ask, "Are not all these people who are speaking Galileans? Then how does each of us hear them in his native language? We are Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, inhabitants of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the districts of Libya near Cyrene, as well as travelers from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. Yet we hear them speaking in our own tongues of the mighty acts of God." The word of the Lord.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Galatians. Brothers and sisters, live by the Spirit, and you will certainly not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh has desires against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. These are opposed to each other, so that you may not do what you want. But if you are guided by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now, the works of the flesh are obvious: immorality, impurity, lust, idolatry, sorcery, hatreds, rivalry, jealousy, outbursts of fury, acts of selfishness, dissensions, factions, occasions of envy, drinking bouts, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do not do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. In contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. Now those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified their flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also follow the Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Together we'll recite the sequence. Come, Holy Spirit, come, and from your celestial home shed a ray of light divine. Come, Father of the poor, come, source of all our store. Come within our bosoms shine, you of comforters the best. You, the soul's most welcome guest, sweet refreshment here below. In our labor, rest most sweet, grateful coolness in the heat, solace in the midst of woe. O most blessed light divine, shine within these hearts of yours and our inmost being fill. Where you are not, we have not. Nothing good in deed or thought, nothing free from taint of ill. Heal our wounds, our strength renew. On our dryness pour your dew. Wash the stains of guilt away. Bend the stubborn heart and will. Melt the frozen, warm the chill. Guide the steps that go astray. On the faithful who adore and confess you evermore, in your sevenfold gift descend. Give them virtue's sure reward. Give them your salvation, Lord. Give them joys that never end. Amen. Hallelujah. Reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "When the Advocate comes, whom I will send you from the Father, the Spirit of truth that proceeds from the Father, he will testify to me. And you also testify, because you have been with me from the beginning. I have much more to tell you, but you cannot bear it now. But when he comes, the Spirit of truth, he will guide you to all truth. He will not speak on his own, but he will speak what he hears and will declare to you the things that are coming. He will glorify me because he will take from what is mine and declare it to you. Everything that the Father has is mine. For this reason, I told you that he will take from what is mine and declare it to you. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus
Christ. If you look at the example of Adam and Eve in the garden, one of the reasons I'm bringing this up is because I was giving the test for First Communion to one of our little kids. I haven't given that test in years because the other people have been doing it. But part of the test was him telling me about the story of Adam and Eve, so it's on my mind. So you remember the story of Adam and Eve, and when they're in the garden, one of the things that's really important for us to remember about the story of Adam and Eve is that it really is our story. God is very patient with us. And yes, there are times where we need to be cast out, we need to be punished, we need to be admonished because we messed up. We violated the love that God has offered to us. And so you have that with Adam and Eve, but God is very patient. Now, for most of us in our journey of faith, there's going to be a process of us entering into the life of the Trinity. For myself, I found it much easier to be able to enter into the understanding of Jesus as the Son of God. So you read about the life of Jesus. You read about him walking through the streets and the miracles that he's doing and the teachings that he's doing. I could relate to that. Even as a teenager, I could relate to that. It doesn't mean that I always followed it, but I could relate to it. But where I really struggled was beyond Jesus, I didn't have a sense of the Holy Spirit. And when I mean a sense of it, I mean a relationship, a deep closeness, as well as with the Father. But I'll save the Father for another day when we talk about the Father. I think we all have a movement like that where we struggle to connect with God in some manner. So I want to talk a little bit about the Holy Spirit. Today's Pentecost, the descent of the Holy Spirit upon the apostles and upon Our Lady, and the disciples. So there is something in our tradition as Catholics where we talk about the seven spiritual works of mercy. Maybe you heard it, maybe you remember it from catechism when you were a little kid and you're like, oh yeah, I don't remember it, right? So there's seven of them. I was listening to a little, watching a little video by Bishop Barron where he was talking about them. And it's been a long time since I just prayed with the spiritual works of mercy. And so I'm not gonna go through all of them today, like talking about them, but I want us to remember that authenticity in our faith bears fruit. And that is a sign that we are authentically encountering and living with God in our daily life. So, for example, the spiritual works of mercy, one is to admonish, kind of like what God did with Adam and Eve. Now, we don't like that one because as human beings, we don't like conflict. We would rather just ignore. We would rather just pretend like we didn't see something happen. But to admonish is rooted in love, not judgment. It is not us going to the world telling the world that it's bad. It is us being brothers and sisters and calling them home. That's what it is, right? Another one is to instruct. The reality is, if we're really honest about the Catholic Church today, we don't really instruct on any deep level the faith. As adults, I mean, there's even most basic things that we did not learn. And I'm not talking about just memorizing. I mean spiritual things within our hearts. I can't tell you how many times people will come to confession, adults will come to confession and say, "Father, I was reading this book and I saw it talking about this one particular sin, and it's like, I never even knew, never even thought about that." So to instruct means the person now has what they need to go deeper, to be more pure in their life. Some of the other spiritual works of mercy: to counsel, right? To help others, to give them insight in their own journey, to comfort, right? We don't want to just admonish people, we want to comfort them too. Oh, and here's my favorite, because it's the one I probably struggle with the most: to bear wrongs patiently. Some of you may have gotten caught in traffic the other night in Everett, where the traffic just got stopped for hours and hours. Road rage. Somebody died that night because of road rage. Our faith helps us to overcome just the anger. It's like everybody today is just on edge. It's almost like the slightest thing will get them to make really bad decisions because of their anger. To bear wrongs patiently. It's rooted in love. It is rooted in love, right? That when we get out in the world, we already are equipped with love. We're already loving whoever it is going to come into our path. So the Holy Spirit wants our faith to be authentic at its core. Now, some of you may be able to relate to something I struggled with for many years in my prayer. I had over-intellectualized my prayer because the reality was I was not open to God. So I would do the words, I would say the words of prayer. I would try to be disciplined about doing it, whether it's prayer cards or praying the rosary, but I really wouldn't let God in, because I don't want to blame anybody, but I would say I didn't really know how to do that, but I just didn't let him in. So the intellectualization of my prayer was that it would become very superficial. I would do it, but not expect anything to come from it. And so there was no fruit. I didn't change. I didn't grow. I didn't mature. It was an obligation, and I felt myself being very diligent, but there was something wrong, resisting the Holy Spirit. Now, there are other people, so maybe you relate to that struggle, but there are other people who maybe struggle in a different way in their prayer, and it is perhaps emotional rather than intellectual. There are some who begin to associate a deep prayer life with the emotions. And so when the tears come during prayer, we can mistakenly think that we need to have those tears in order to have a sincere relationship with God. Don't get me wrong. It's good to have tears in prayer every once in a while, right? It can be a sign that God is really working. But then there are some who say when they don't have the tears, something's wrong. And so what do? They stop praying because they're not feeling anything. And so prayer and this authentic union with God is not just intellectual, nor is it just emotional, but it is rooted in faith. And faith is not just intellectual or emotional. It's rooted in hope and love. And so for us to remember those three things, it's rooted in faith, hope, and love. Someone who has faith sincerely, joyfully wants God's will. Every day they wake up and it's like, "Lord, I'm excited. I just want to do what you want me to do. I just want to follow you today." That's faith. That's authentic. Someone who has authentic hope is someone who looks at the future not primarily with anxiety and fear and stress or depression, but looks at the future seeing God working in your life, in my life, in the world. We can look at all the problems in the world, and then you watch a saint, you watch someone who's very saintly, and they will still have hope because they know God is working through all of it. Now, I'm not saying that something's bad if somebody's struggling with stress or anxiety or depression, but we long for hope, to always be able to see that positive, what God is doing. Now, love, I want to talk a little bit about love, which is, I think, more... Sometimes we need a little love, right? Okay. All right. So, the first form of love is not necessarily bad, but it is not complete. So the Greek word is eros. It is the love that is drawn by attraction. We could talk about food. We could say, you know what, after Mass, we're all going to go to the restaurant, but we all have to agree on ordering the exact same thing. Now, that's going to violate our eros, because we want to order, we want to eat what gives us pleasure, and we don't all agree, right? Sometimes when I go to one of the Mexican restaurants, I love ordering tacos, I love tacos, but if I'm sitting with somebody who orders tongue in their tacos, I wish I didn't go. I wish I hadn't gone. It's like, why would you want to eat somebody's tongue? Okay, so eros is we all have something that gives us pleasure, and then we all have our personal appetites, right? You know, it can even extend to colors. You think of like stained glass. We kind of have stained glass here, right? Colored glass. We all have favorite colors. Personal preference. So if you were to look at stained glass windows and say, you know, I really love the red, or I love the blue, okay? It is something that gives me pleasure, but it is focused on the self. Now, I want to use this idea of the stained glass and light to show us this journey to God. So today, you'll see rainbows in flags. You'll see it symbolizing some political view on things. But I want to take the rainbow and go back maybe a little bit more to the biblical understanding of it. Rainbows are actually pretty amazing, physically speaking, the phenomenon of a rainbow. It is light being split apart. And so you're seeing different colors of the light band individually. And you could say there's a certain beauty to it, probably because we just don't see it every day. And everybody would look at the rainbow and say, oh, my favorite color is. And we'd all have a different favorite color. And so I think that's kind of like humanity, where we can go through life with eros, we can live for what gives us pleasure, but it divides us also, if that's all we have. I think today, one of the traps in our world of not having God, not having the Holy Spirit, is we become trapped by our own personal preference or like or something that gives me pleasure. And people will fight to the death to make sure that no one ever makes them give that up. And so you can look at something beautiful like the rainbow, but recognize it's not necessarily what should be normal. What is normal? Well, it's white light. And white light is not the absence of color, but it is all the colors who have simultaneously said, we are going to sacrifice our beauty, our color, so that we can reform into one color, which is white light. That's what we see from the sun every single day. That's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit takes the beauty and the unique identity we all have as individuals, but calls us to surrender on some level, whatever may be self-centered or selfish, if you will, and we sacrifice that for something more beautiful. Jesus Christ giving himself to us is showing us the beauty of that. I think that's what we need today, is something beautiful. Now, that form of love we call agape. It is not love based on attraction, but it is love based on that which is unattractive, but the desire within our heart is to help it become something pure and attractive. I desire good where there is no good. I desire to bring purity where there is no purity, to desire love where there is no love. That is agape. That is the fruit of the Holy Spirit. It is a sign of authentic prayer when we desire that. It fills us. If you were to think of the animals getting on Noah's Ark, and I remember as a little boy when we would go to the zoo, for some reason, one of my favorite animals to see was the peacock. Maybe it was the sound they made. Maybe it was their strut. But they were just arrogant little birds, and they wanted attention, and they would show all their colors, right? There's something about it that seems to be attractive. But you remember the story of Noah in the ark when the rains begin to subside? Noah doesn't send out a peacock. Well, I don't know if peacocks can even fly. He sends out a dove. A dove has no color. In the sense, a dove is pure, pure white. It becomes a symbol of leading the people to a place of purity. In the second reading today, you have a list of all things that are impure, things that are self-centered. And then it has a list of things that are pure. You notice today in our world, people can talk about their preferences, we can talk about sexuality, we can talk about gender all day long, and nobody talks about purity. Purity, to have one's heart be united to God's love, to be moved by the Holy Spirit, to be rooted in agape love. That dove leads the people on the ark, leads all the animals that are on that ark to a place of purity. We often show the Holy Spirit as a dove coming down from heaven. I think that's what our world is in the end looking for. It's that purity that God seeks and desires to offer us. Together we profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the Holy Spirit was incarnate to the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, who will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who
proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Since God endows us with the gift of his own life by imparting the Holy Spirit, let us come to him with prayers inspired by the Holy Spirit. Let us come to him alive and free in the divine presence.
For all who have been signed and sealed with the Holy Spirit, that this church may be united as one body, made of many parts, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the peoples of the world who do not know God, that the Spirit of truth proclaimed to every nation may indeed renew the face of the earth, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the outpouring of the Spirit of peace, that men and women may know the forgiveness of their sins, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For this community gathered by God, that the Spirit who makes holy our Eucharistic gifts may strengthen and refresh us, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the souls of the departed, that they may be made perfect in the life-giving spirit, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Father all-powerful, receive these prayers from a people made one by the Holy Spirit, who always dwells within us through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Number 311.
Oh, praise on me.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Grant, we pray, O Lord, that as promised by your Son, the Holy Spirit may reveal to us more abundantly the hidden mystery of this sacrifice, and graciously lead us into all truth, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for bringing your Paschal mystery to completion. You bestowed the Holy Spirit today on those you made your adopted children by uniting them to your only begotten Son. This same Spirit, as the Church came to birth, opened to all people the knowledge of God, and brought together the many languages of the earth in profession of one faith. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land and every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. You are indeed holy and to be glorified, O God, who love the human race and who always walk with us on the journey of life. Blessed indeed is your Son present in our midst when we are gathered by his love. And when, as once for the disciples, so now for us, he opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father most merciful, we ask that you send forth your Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, he took bread and said the blessing, broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, gave you thanks, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith.
We eat this bread and drink this cup. We proclaim.
Therefore, Holy Father, as we celebrate the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Savior, whom you led through his passion and death on the cross to the glory of the resurrection, and whom you have seated at your right hand, we proclaim the work of your love until he comes again. We offer you the bread of life and the chalice of blessing. Look with favor on the oblation of your church, in which we show forth the paschal sacrifice of Christ that has been handed on to us, and grant that by the power of the Spirit of your love, we may be counted now and until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we have communion. Lord, renew your church by the light of the gospel. Strengthen the bond of unity between the faithful and the pastors of your people, together with Francis, our Pope, and Paul, our Archbishop, and the whole order of bishops, that in a world torn by strife, your people may shine forth as a prophetic sign of unity and concord. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the peace of Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever, there in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, with the apostles and martyrs, and with all the saints, we shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Together we pray as Jesus taught us. Lord, we pray, from every evil, graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of our Lord's peace.
Miserere nobis, adius Dei.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Body of Christ. The blood of Christ.
For those of you who are unable to receive the Eucharist at this time, we offer this spiritual communion prayer. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot, at this moment, receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Our communion hymn is in your additional music guide on page 6.
Yeah. Let us pray.
O God, who bestow heavenly gifts upon your church, safeguard, we pray, the grace you have given, that the gift of the Holy Spirit poured out upon her may retain all its force, and that this spiritual food may gain her abundance of eternal redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just a couple announcements. This is a reminder of Faith on Fire Conference Retreat in Anacortes will be June 21st to the 23rd. You might consider carpooling if you like, but it's really worth going at least for a day just to be part of that conference. The Hispanic community has a retreat today, so we cannot use the hall, so we will have coffee and donuts outside. So if you like to just kind of hang out there, you're certainly welcome to do so. For those who have not yet made a donation to the annual appeal, please consider doing so. There are envelopes around, and I'm sure you've received them in your home. And so for those who have donated already, thank you. The office is open today after Mass. And just a little update about our parish family. So remember, that all begins July 1st. I've talked to all the different parishes. We've had meetings in all the parishes except here. So part of the reason for that is because in some of the proposed changes for Mass schedules for Sunday and, especially Sunday, none of the Masses are changing here in Marysville. So we will have an 8 a.m., 10 a.m., and a noon Mass in Spanish for the time being. So I'm just reminding everybody, this is kind of a short-term schedule to last 6 months to a year, and in which we're going to have more conversations about the future. So for those who are connected to St. Cecilia's in any way in Stanwood, their Sunday Mass schedule is going to go from having a Mass at 9 and 11, they're going to combine them and just have a Mass at 10 on Sundays. The Sunday schedule in Arlington at Immaculate Conception, they have a Mass at 9 a.m. and that Mass is going to be moved to 8 a.m. So it's a little bit earlier now. The reason for those two changes is so that when I'm in the rotation, I can get back here in time for the Spanish Mass. On Saturday evenings, we normally don't have a Mass here, but in the other two parishes, we've moved their Masses. So at St. Cecilia's in Stanwood, their evening Mass will move to 6 p.m., from 5 p.m. to 6 p.m., and then in Arlington at Immaculate Conception, their evening Mass moves from 5 p.m. to 4 p.m. Now, Darrington, just in case you ever find yourself out in Darrington for some reason, at St. John's, their Sunday Mass is at noon right now, and that is going to move to 11 a.m. on Saturday. We can get permission to do that if we have a parish that's really far away, to move it to a different time for the sake of the priest to be able to get out there. So they will have an 11 a.m. Mass on Saturdays, which is their Sunday Mass. So that's Sunday. Daily Mass schedule is completely getting changed everywhere. We're changing the confession schedules completely, but I promise you there will be plenty of time because we're all good sinners, right? We all need confession. There will be plenty of time for confession, and we will also have a lot of daily Masses. Now, in saying all of this, Father Raja, who is the priest who's coming to help, who was supposed to come July 1st, just notified me that he needs to go back to India for 3 weeks. They're voting for their new provincial back there. So he won't be here until later in July, and we'll figure everything out at that point. So there's a lot more information, but that's it for today. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you all in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Let us go in peace.
Thanks be to God.